So glad that you can be here with us this morning. So we're celebrating Christmas. We're having the opportunity to celebrate baptisms today as well. It's going to be a beautiful morning as we spend this time together. All of it is a celebration of how good He has been to us. Our Savior has been wonderful to us. You know, Christmas is a wonderful time of the year. I think most people look forward to Christmas time with a special anticipation, as Christmas is viewed by many, I think, as a season of giving, a wonderful time of giving gifts and receiving gifts. And Christmas stories seem to center around the idea of gifts given and received. And maybe you're familiar with O. Henry's story about the gift of the Magi. That's always one that comes to mind for me at this time. A story about a couple so poor that their only treasures were her beautiful hair and his treasured pocket watch. And they come to Christmas Eve with no money to buy a gift, so she decides to cut her hair to buy a chain for his watch, not knowing that he has decided to sell his chain to buy combs for her hair. And so they come, but the gifts are not in vain, as you might think, because they are received for what they are, sacrificial gifts of love, a great expression of love and giving to each other. And hopefully we find the joy in giving as we come to Christmas time. I remember how exciting it was, you know, when we were raising our kids, Lauren, Lacey, and Landon, when they were really little. You know, they're all grown now, but when they were really little, I remember how exciting it was when we saw them begin to understand Jesus' words, "It's more blessed to give than to receive," right? And they began to understand that joy of giving to someone else, and the exciting of finding something special for them, and even wrapping it up and preparing it and being able to give something to someone else. And it's a beautiful thing. Far too many miss the giving or the loving, or even if they may get a hold of the giving and the loving, they still miss the why. You know, it's all about the gift that God gave to us. It's all because of the Christmas story. We've been going through this Christmas story again this month with the idea of story and book and movies and plays and the way those lay out in stories. There's so many stories about Christmas, and they convey beautiful thoughts and they draw our attention back, but our focus needs to be on the story. There is one story that is above every story, that story about Jesus. And it's a hero story. You know, I notice in the movies these days that hero stories have become very popular again. Hero stories, there's lots of them out there. And I think even more than the action and the excitement of those movies, that people long to see a hero. They long for a hero. We look for someone who is selfless, brave, giving, and strong. One who accomplishes what the ordinary person cannot, and one who does for others something that we could never repay or do for ourselves. And every story has its hero within that story, but one story reveals the hero of heroes, and that's our story. It's God's gift. God's gift was that hero that we needed. And so we return to the story again this morning. We've been looking at different passages of Scripture that reveal Him, and we've talked about looking at the story from the beginning, and we talked about the conflict in the story. And this week I want to talk to you about the hero of the story. We've been singing about Him this morning, that hero of the story who came. And God's story is so beautiful from beginning to end as we see it throughout the pages of Scripture. One of the most beautiful passages that describe that hero for us comes from the pages of Isaiah. And it was written 700 years before He was born. Because as we've talked about, God's story was in place from before the beginning because of God's love for us. And God's story has been in play all through the Scriptures because that was His promise to us. And finally, we see the power of God revealed in that name of Jesus that we've been singing about. And so I want to take you to Isaiah chapter 9 this morning, a familiar passage of Scripture as we bring it to light about Christmas. Isaiah wrote, and he said, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned." You see, this hero that came for us, the gift that God gave, he is a gift of hope, a gift of hope where there is hopelessness. Isaiah begins by declaring a message of hope, light in the darkness. And following prophecy about captivity and God hiding his face from Jacob, he speaks about a broken relationship with him that had left them in deep darkness. But now he begins to speak about the light that was coming, the light that God would bring. And it's a picture of all of us really lost in our sin and lost in the darkness before his light comes to us and the hopelessness that encompasses that. John's gospel, as we looked at a couple of weeks ago, reveals and speaks of Jesus as the light that has come into the world. He was the light that had come. He is the light for us. And it's a fitting message for us today. Probably no holiday or season is more often declared a favorite than Christmas time as we come to it. And yet, in contrast to that sentiment, the statistics would show and tell us that depression and suicide are at their peak during Christmas time. Because along with that light that points us to something different, there's the realization of that darkness, and there's a great deal of introspection that goes on. People take the time to step back and they remember maybe their favorite memories of Christmas when they were a child, and now as an adult they think, where has that gone? Or where have I come to out of what my expectations and my hopes were? Or they evaluate, you know, maybe they've gone through a broken marriage. Maybe they're estranged from their family and their children. Maybe they find themselves someplace they never thought they would be. And so in that reflection, they see the darkness. And yet the message is not one to point out the darkness, because the light dispels the darkness. And we had the privilege to go out to the festival out at the Nature Center last night. It's our first time to get to have that experience. And the lanterns, the ice lanterns, I thought they were beautiful. It was amazing. You know, it's gorgeous to walk through those trails again, all lit up. But I was reminded thinking about darkness again. You know, we've just passed the winter solstice, the shortest day of the year. And I know Ken's been counting. He tells me every day, hey, it's only a couple more days, you know, and then they start getting longer again. You know, the sun is coming back. We like the light, right? But you know, when you think about the darkness and the light, darkness is really not something of its own. Darkness is the absence of the light. But whenever there is light, it dispels the darkness. Darkness can never overcome light. Light always shines out through the darkness. And this message of hope that we had, this message that Isaiah was bringing was, hey, in the darkness, there's light. There's light, and you can see it, and you can draw close to it, and you can begin to feel the warmth of it, and it can begin to dispel the darkness in our situation. And so in spite of the darkness and the hopelessness, and the posts are out there and people that are experiencing that, we need to be aware to bring some light into that darkness, because Isaiah wrote about a darkness and a hopelessness as well, but in the passage he declares a message of hope coming out of despair. He goes on in verse 3 and he says, "You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest and as men rejoice when dividing the plunder." He speaks of great gain, of increase, of benefit, of the things that we celebrate and enjoy. You know, great harvests like Thanksgiving that we just celebrated, plunder and spoils, you know, victory, the celebration after a tough battle. And when the victory is there, we celebrate in the spoils. And he's speaking of God taking away the despair and bringing joy, real joy, into our lives. The weight that we've been under has been lifted. Victory has come. Verse 4, he begins to illustrate that. He says, "For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor." And he's speaking of bondage being broken. It tells us of the end of slavery and oppression, freedom that's coming. God has ended our slavery to sin and death and set us free into life in him. This illustration that he gives about Midian, I don't know how much you remember from your Old Testament about Midian, but Midian actually was a country that developed from another one of the sons of Abraham. Abraham had a son with a wife named Keturah, and she was sent away, and he was given gifts, but he was not given the inheritance, and Midian became a nation that then fought against Israel. And they brought a lot of trouble to them, and they actually deeply impoverished them. They would come in and raid the land. It said they were like locusts. They would come in and just take everything, you know, and leave them impoverished. And they would bring this oppression against them. And eventually, in the time of the judges, God raises up Gideon. You remember Gideon, right? And Gideon, he leads against him. He keeps weeding out his army. No, you got too many people. You got too many people. I want them to know this is not something you did because you were strong, but something I did because I chose to bless you. And so he gets him down to 300 guys against thousands and brings a great victory. That's the story that Isaiah refers back to here, like that time of Midian when they were so oppressed, so beaten down. And he says, God brings the victory. He's saying this one has come who is the light, who's going to bring this victory. And so he goes on and he says, every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning. It'll be fuel for the fire because that time of fighting and warring and battles will be past. It speaks and declares the end of the battle, the end of the war, that God has already accomplished the victory for us. And so this Christmas time that we celebrate, it is indeed a time of celebration because this story is for us. And he goes on and he tells us the why and the how. And this is the part we probably know best from this prophecy in verse 6 where he says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And he is a gift to us of joy. Just as we started out singing this morning, joy to the world. And we can think of that very easily. You know, the nativity story is so appealing to us. Our greatest stories, the greatest moments, the moments we have to celebrate beyond all others are Christmas and Easter, right? Easter being our life that we have in him, the purpose that he came for. But Easter seems more grim as we think about his death and his suffering. But when we look at that baby in the manger, you know, you just kind of light up, right? You just kind of glow. You kind of smile. Who doesn't smile over a newborn baby? I mean, who doesn't, you know? And you hold them in your arms, and it's beautiful, and it's just a sweet moment. And so we think about that sweet moment of Mary and Joseph, even if they had to be in the stable in that moment, holding that baby in their arms, God had brought joy in that moment. And it was the gift of Christmas, not like the world's commercial materialism that is out there about all the things that will supposedly make you happy, but there was joy. And Isaiah tells us that a child would be born at a specific time in history. And again, Isaiah was writing this 700 years in advance because God was revealing his promise. And God keeps his promises. And all of his promises are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. And so Christmas is all about a child that was born, a bundle of joy, for Jesus was fully man, and he came into the world as all men do. He was born as a baby. He was born of a woman, but he was no ordinary child. He's not like every other man, because he existed before all things were made, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago. And he was conceived into human form by the Holy Spirit and born of a virgin. And so he was different. And that's why this verse says not only that a child is born, but also that a son is given. That's not just poetic. That's not just repetitive. It's not redundant. It was Isaiah making the point. Yes, a child is born, and a son, the son, who existed from the beginning, has been given. Given to us. As a gift from God, given to us as the hero of our story, the deliverer, the one who would come to set things right. And Jesus is God's gift given. He is that good news of great joy that the angels sang about in Luke chapter 2. He's the one that we read about being God himself and yet not being proud, willing to be humbled and put into flesh like us, willing to put on skin like us and walk among us. And he's the one that we just talked about in Ephesians, that though we were dead, God made us alive through him. And so that's the message of hope that we have. God, rich in his mercy, saved us through this gift that he gave. And this child is to be a ruler. As it speaks of government resting upon his shoulder, this is God himself, the one to come, the one who will rule and reign forever. Our wonderful counselor, the very incarnation of perfect wisdom and having the words of life, the mighty God in whom is all the fullness of God in bodily form, the everlasting Father, Jesus in his earthly life and ministry said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. He is the Prince of Peace, giving us peace with God and ultimately perfect and eternal peace that we have in Him. To us a child is born. To us a son is given. Whose son? He's God's son. And He's God's gift to us. To us. The point for us today is that He is a gift also to be received. Yeah, I've heard it said that a gift is never really a gift until it's received. You can go and find the right gift, and you can buy it and purchase it. You can take it home. You can wrap it up beautiful and put a bow on it and have it all ready. You can put it under the Christmas tree, or you can take it and personally deliver it to somebody. But if they won't take it, if they won't receive it, if they won't open it, the gift really isn't delivered. It isn't given. It's a gift that was provided, but it really becomes the gift when it's received. You know, when they take it, when they embrace it, when they humbly accept what you have done for them, that's the gift. You know, a great preacher I look back to, I love history and I love some of those preachers from the past, Charles Spurgeon, once said of this passage on Isaiah, he said, "If this child who now lies before the eyes of your faith, wrapped in swaddling clothes in Bethlehem's manger, is born to you, my hearer, then you are born again. For this child is not born to you unless you are born to this child." For God has called us to new life in Him. And we are given, are we given to Him? Have we received God's incredible gift and allowed Him to begin to effect the change that He works in us from the inside out to make us truly His, to move us from darkness into the light? From bondage to freedom, from defeat to victory, and from death to life. The path to life is in dying to ourselves and giving ourselves completely to Him. He's done what we could not do. He's played the role of the hero. He's defeated our enemy. He's given us the path of victory and said, "Here, I'm handing it to you as a gift," as we embrace what He has done for us. Those who merely want to admire the baby in the manger, that great picturesque scene, that sweet moment, are like those the Scripture says cry, "Peace, peace," but there is no peace. The peace comes as we embrace Him in our lives. He's intended to be for us not only a gift of hope and a gift of joy, but a gift of peace. This passage, I want to finish with verse 7 in this passage where Isaiah continues and he says, "Of the increase of His government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over His kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." You see, He is also for us a gift of peace. A gift of peace. He is the promise that came before the law and will remain after the law is no longer needed. The gift is peace with God and life with Him forever. Not like all the crazy, hectic craziness that we go through. And you know, even Christmas time gets so derailed from being a message of peace. I see so many people that are so stressed at Christmas. By the time they're trying to keep up with their calendar, "I've got this thing and that thing and this thing and that thing, and I've got to be ready for this, that, and the other," and the shopping they're trying to get in and the things that they're trying to do, and they're just like, "Oh, it's crazy." It's meant to be peace. The gift that God has brought to us is peace. That there is nothing that we can strive for to accomplish on our own. That there is nothing left to be done. That we've been made right with Him. That we can enjoy the sweet pleasure of His company to be in His presence. And just to enjoy being with Him. That we will have life with Him forever. He does rule over all. Just as Philippians 2 tells us, one day every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We can bank on it, because just as this passage says, the zeal of the Lord God will accomplish this. It'll all be done. That's why Isaiah could tell us about the baby 700 years before he was born, because God keeps His promises, and nothing messes with His plans. Nothing derails them. Nothing sets them on a detour. And that's why Paul tells us in Galatians 4 about Jesus. He said, "When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption, that we might become his kids. This is a lasting peace and a lasting promise, the gift that keeps on giving. Now that's something to celebrate in the story that we have, the hero that's come and the things that he's done. We can think about our favorite hero and the way that we celebrate them and cheer them on and the things that we're doing, the way that you get behind them and you're like, yeah, this is our hero. The one who's accomplished it all, the one who fought for us and brought victory, the one we can celebrate with forever. God's amazing gift. A son is given. It is the Christmas story, and it is our story. And he is the hero that we've longed for. And to the one that's lost in hopelessness and despair, along has come a hero, a gift that turns life around, a gift of hope and joy and peace. But the gift is not really a gift until we receive it. So I challenge you today to receive that gift in all the fullness that it brings, to celebrate it, to tell everyone you can about it. There are so many who still need to hear this story, that need to know. This is a story to warm our hearts and a story to give us reason to live. It's a story that begs to be told and a story behind the gifts that we give at Christmas. It's the gift from our Father in heaven. And we have an opportunity to celebrate that today, the testimony in people's lives in baptism. Some people may wonder, you're having baptisms at Christmas? Yeah, I can't think of a better time to have a baptism than Christmas. You know, on somebody's birthday, we usually take gifts and give them to that person. And like we said, you know, here it was Jesus' birthday, and he is the gift, and he gives that gift to us. But I can't think of any better way for us to celebrate as a church family than to celebrate people as they're giving their hearts back to him, you know, and stepping out for that and stepping across the line. And so we get to celebrate that today, testimonies of people who have embraced that story, who have received the gift that was given for them, whose lives have been transformed out of the darkness into the light, out of the despair into hope, from death to life. And they're coming out to say they want to be a part of that. So those of you that are going to be baptized this morning, if you want to slip out, we're going to get to that here in just a moment. You can get ready as we're going to celebrate that together. But it is that moment, and baptism is such a great moment of celebration for us as a church family. You know, that was what he commanded us to do as a testimony. There's nothing that happens in this tank over here that's magical or new or special. What's already happened is what God's done on the inside. As he brings that life and that transformation from the inside out, the opportunity to get in that water is the opportunity just to identify with him. He said, as we go down under the water, we identify with Jesus and his death as we rise up to new life in him, as a symbol of a picture that we are his and we belong to him. And the beauty of this moment for the individuals being baptized is it's their day to say, yeah, that's my hero. That's my hero, and he is mine, and I am his. And that's what we're going to do as we celebrate these baptisms this morning. You know, 2 weeks ago we considered how the story began in the love of God from before the beginning. And last week we celebrated communion, remembering that the story is about the promise of God in what he was doing for us. And today we have the special opportunity to celebrate, even with baptism, as people are expressing the power of God revealed in us and the transformation that he brings in our life. Jesus, our hero. Would you stand with me this morning? I want to pray with you and for you this morning. And we're going to have a song of worship as we transition to the baptism here in just a moment. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for the awesome love that you have for us, for the beauty of the story, Lord, for the opportunity to celebrate this Christmas here and now at this place, at this time, with the family that you placed around us. Lord, may we be reminded as we look in each other's face of the love that you have for us. Lord, as we wish one another Merry Christmas, may we realize that what we're wishing them is all the joy and fullness of your gift that's been given to us. Lord, may we mean that with great sincerity. Lord, may we honor you and worship you today in the songs that we sing, in the attitude of our hearts, in being like you and being a giver as we gift and give gifts and try to bless and love those around us well. Lord, may we celebrate it in these lives that we see that have been transformed and touched and changed, that they want to step out and say, yes, this is what he's done for me. Lord, may we take the story to heart. May it be behind everything that we do. May it change the way that we live. Lord, may it be on our hearts and on our lips that we express it and share it with those that still walk in the darkness. Lord, those that are still living in fear and bondage and sorrow and despair. Lord, may we share the hope that we have in him. And Lord, may you make this indeed the most blessed time of the year. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.